Dilip, Code on Julia, and we even had a talk on how to connect Julia Code, how to connect with Julia program to database, and even our optimization. We had a talk on optimization too. So now we will focus on testing. So now we'll focus on how to make your code reliable. So Julia gives you a lot of packages for testing. We will discuss these packages today. First one is code coverage. Julia has built-in support for code coverage. So in order to use the code coverage, let me tell you what the code coverage actually is. So let's say you have a test file and you don't know how much of your code is actually being covered by your test. How much of code is actually being covered by your test case, test program. So this is where the code coverage actually comes in. So in order to use the code coverage, all you have to do is start Julia in the code coverage mode, and this is the command to start Julia in the code coverage mode. And once you're inside the Julia REPL, you just run your tests on your project. So that's it. And now exit out of Julia. Now log into Julia with regular mode, like /Julia. Now that you're in the Julia with the regular mode, you can use a package called coverage. So the first thing is you have to actually change your directory to the directory wherever your project is located. Once you're in that directory, you can call in a function called process folder. What this function does is once you run your test program in the coverage mode, Julia actually creates .coi files for every .jl file .jl file that actually ran in your test file. So this process folder will access these .coi files, and it will actually store the entire summary inside the variable. So we have just named the variable as coverage in this case. So we are actually extracting just two variables out of this summary. We are extracting number of lines covered and total number of lines. So now you have number of lines covered by your test case and total number of lines in your program. So it's just a matter of you just need to take a percentage of it to check the code coverage of your project. So next is. There may arise a situation where you want to check the memory allocation of your program. So this is how we do it. Julia gives you built-in support for this. You should start Julia in the memory allocation mode. This is how we do it. Julia /the top line. So that's how we started off. And here's the next step. What you should do is you should run your program twice. Not just once. You should run your test scripts or run your program twice. Once you're done with it, you have to exit the memory allocation mode and you have to enter back into Julia in the regular mode. So both the purposes are same. You just have to enter your project folder and call either one of these functions depending on your Julia version. If it is 0.3, you have to call the clear malloc, and if it's 0.4, you have to do profile of clear malloc. So what this does is once you run your program in the memory allocation mode, Julia will do a similar process. It creates .mem files for every .jl file that you have in your project. And this function actually analyzes the .mem file, and it gives you the output of where exactly the memory is being allocated, and if there are any general views, you can actually optimize your code using this. So these are the next things. So Julia, apart from this, Julia even provides you with a lot of macros which you can actually measure the performance. The first, as Nishant discussed, at time. So I will not reconfirm that once again. There is one more function called at time. So there is a difference between time and at time. Time actually returns more. It returns a different set of parameters. It returns the returns the value of the expression, the value of the function that you are actually calling it, and elapsed time, whatever the time it is, but total, and even the garbage collection time is the extra thing, extra parameter that it returns, which at time doesn't do. So at allocated, it does the same thing. At allocated, it gives you the memory allocation that your program is actually taking. So you can use at allocated to check whether how much memory is being allocated for your program. So next is lint. My friend detailed covered about lint, so I will not go through it once again. Yeah, that should be all from there. Oh, sorry, it was based on desk. Yeah, I don't know. This is a built-in. Package called base.test. Base.test actually, what it does, it makes your test cases readable. So this is a simple thing. Like at test one is good one. Let's just say you're preparing your test cases to test your project, and you want these test cases to be displayed in a very readable format. This is where base.test comes in. You can just compare your test cases against the predicted values, and it will give the output. And you can even throw in custom error messages in these test cases. If the predicted output is not equal to whatever you are expecting. So the base.test gives a very less approximations. There are two functions related to this, and both are related to floating point numbers. So what this does is this just approximately this just approximately compares the number with the integer value with the floating point number. So fact check is actually an improvement of base.test. This gives a lot more flexibility for you over base.test. It's even much simpler to use. What improvements it gives over base.test is you actually have a lot of functions in here. You can compare the exact value of it, and you can compare the roughly whatever approximation you saw over there. It's even present in here. And apart from this, there are many other functions there. Less than, greater than, equal. These kind of functions are not present in base.test.
That's
right. Okay. Yeah, that should go. Do you have any questions?
We'll see a lot more of the test frameworks and stuff tomorrow in the workshop, but we now switch over to Jeff.
Yeah, okay.